Ships to carry the war for freedom to a dozen fronts. Ships to sail from 100 ports with food and medicine, tires and tanks. 7 tons of precious cargo for every fighter on battlefields strung halfway around the world. 7,000 miles to MacArthur in Australia. 11,000 miles to Aden in the Persian Gulf. 11,000 miles. 4 months of sailing. And at the end of it, like as not, a torpedo, an oil slick, and 1,000 lives lost. To this mounting challenge of distance and danger, there can be but one full answer. Ships. Little ships. Big ships. Slow ships. Fast ships. And Americans have rushed to meet that challenge with an answer sharp and pointed as a bayonet. Americans are building ships, as ships were never built before. In 50 shipyards around the nation's coastline, workers take up new jobs. Lights burn nightly in 1,000 school shops as young and old learn new skills. Schoolgirls turn welder. Housewives learn the secret of the micrometer. Musicians become masters of the turning lathe. Stenographers and salesmen. Teachers and clerks become die casters and electricians and pattern makers and pipe fitters. Fresh from the classrooms into the yards they pour, Swede rubs elbows with Irishmen. White collar workers team with old hands in the crafts. Grandfathers take up their tools again along with youngsters filling their first jobs. It's ships and men and ships, as the nation's great new workers' army swings into the rhythm of 1,000 unfamiliar tasks. As shipways, and beyond them still more shipways, rise against the sky to build a new and mighty lifeline for the United Nations. Slowly at first, but with increasing tempo as great hulls rise in a score of yards, shipways and shops become hungry monsters, greedy for steel. Steel for deckhouses. Steel for ventilators. Steel for gun turrets, hulls and bulkheads. Steel for the rigging, masts and crow's nests of 1,000 sturdy vessels. Men build ships, but they must have metal. And scrap is the mother of steel. Boilers and bathtubs, jalopies and junk, tedders and wagon tires, rails and waffle irons, even the kitchen stove, join the mountain of scrap to feed electric furnaces and be born anew. Thousands of kilowatts of electric heat cook the worn-out salvage down into a metallic mulligan stew. Salted with fresh alloys, the blazing brew gains strength and authority to withstand the tests of modern war. Yeah. Cast into a thousand strange and useful shapes, the strong new metal is poured and molded on 100 foundry floors. Heated, reheated, annealed and pressed, ton upon ton of sturdy steel plate is rolled by a score of mills to be scaled, pounded and bent at white-hot temperatures to the needs of victory. Castings from foundries join plate from rolling mills and the vast sweep of supplies to the production lines of a score of shipyards spaced around the country's rim. Swung from the loading platform into plate shops big as a ballpark, eased into place by electric cranes, the heavy steel is cut by the miracle of oxyethylene, one of the hottest flames known to man. Huge templates, basically no different than your mother's paper dress pattern, serve as guides for chalk lines to which the cutters hew. Punched and drilled and bent and shaped and drilled and bent and shaped again, the metal is swung from tool to tool, faster and still faster, as new shortcuts in production are perfected. Parts are machined and milled to join the never-ending stream to the assembly floor, where a new miracle of speed has revolutionized shipbuilding since the First World War. Welding! Electric power for joining steel with a white-hot arc that leaves a barely visible seam. Electric welding! To build whole deck houses, gun turrets, stern and bow assemblies simultaneously, while parent hulls rise steadily to completion. Welding! With which one man can join as much metal as three old-time riveters. Remember that old triple play? From forge to pitcher to bucket? It took more than a million rivets to build one ship, with the riveters swarming over the hulls like flies in a slice of melon. They broke a record, too. They built one ship in 226 days. But this is an age of power. With a few electric welders, you can lay your steel plates in the ground, stitch them together in sections big as a dance floor, and hoist them onto a ship's hull fast as you can say, Schickelgruber. Did someone say 226 days? Time is short. Mr. Hitler won't wait. The boys at Oregon Ship built the Star of Oregon, First Liberty Hull of World War II, in 153. Then 112 days to complete the Robert Fulton. 99 days to build the Alexander Hamilton, complete from keel to deckhouse. 88 days for the Philip Schuyler with masts and funnel standing, and the next one faster. 64 days for the Fisher Ames. Then the boys really got warmed up. 49. 26. The Joseph M. Teal slips into the quiet water of a great river, which, harnessed by man's ingenuity, makes possible the Northwest's miracle of ships. Men build ships. Steel is the fabric. But tools provide the speed. And electricity, with the speed of light, is the swiftest tool at man's command. A million years of evolution and a decade of human skill and planning have forged the swift waters of the Columbia into one great tool. Bonneville Dam, built and owned by the people of the United States, presses kilowatts from falling waters for 100 high-speed weapons. 400 miles upstream, Grand Coulee, biggest dam ever built, swells the supply of power needed to turn the wheels of war. Without hydropower from these two giant fortresses of the Columbia, without the tons of water falling against the blades of giant turbines, there might be no power for steel, no power for lathes and presses, no electric power for the welding arc, for lifting and for cutting. Without the mile upon mile of gleaming cable, highways on which a billion electric horses gallop from powerhouse to deep water ports, no new ship would set their courses from the Columbia. Columbia River power is striking power, power for victory and for peace, power with which to prove the challenge of a great American.
We shall carry the attack against the enemy. We shall hit him and hit him again wherever and whenever we can reach him. We must keep him far from our shores, for we intend to bring this battle to him on his own home ground.